step out of my comfort zone to the realm of the unknown where Jesus is. And he's holding out his hand, waves are calling out my name, and they laugh at me, reminding me of all the times I've tried before and failed. The waves, they keep on telling me time and time again, oh, you'll never win, never win. But the voice of truth tells me a different story.
Welcome to worship. We're so glad to have you with us today, and a special thank you and recognition. We have our St. A's Summer Singers with us today, so thank you all for being here to lead us in worship. Some announcements as we're getting started. Hopefully you've had a chance to kind of get a little preview of our crafters pop-up craft and bake sale there in the back of the room. There's some really beautiful things, and I think it's going to be feedbacking. Perfect. There's some beautiful things in the back of the room, so you want to stop by and check those out. And a huge thank you to our crafters, as well as our families that provided items for the bake sale. All of the proceeds from this will go to support our youth on their summer trip to the ELCA Youth Gathering in New Orleans, followed by a few days of civil rights history in Alabama. So stop by and check out all those goodies there. If you are going to be a part of our new members class, that will be happening just shortly after the service here in the community center as well. We'll probably set things up so that the new members class will be on this side of the room after our service, and lunch will be provided for that. And it's not too late to join in. If you have questions about joining St. Andrew's or what membership means, you can still come be a part of that today. Then later today, we do have our final trip meeting for those students heading to our summer trip for the ELCA Youth Gathering, so that'll be from 3 to 4:30. I think that one will be over in our sanctuary. In the week ahead, our LWR quilters will meet on Monday at 10, and then our summer craft and quilting group will meet on Wednesday at 10, and our Seekers book discussion group will also meet Wednesday night at 6. And then next weekend, we do have two memorial services, one on Saturday, one on Sunday. And the Sunday one is for Lowell Dinas, and so just a reminder about that, that'll be at 1:30, followed by a time of reception here in the community center. I do want to say a huge thank you to everybody who helps, is a part of a help team that provides food and refreshments for the reception time following our memorial services. It's such a huge ministry, an important part of the hospitality we provide for families. So I want to say a huge thank you to all of you for supporting those help teams, and then as well to Heidi Martinez, who's doing such a great job coordinating all of that. It's also camp season now that summer has begun, so our confirmation campers will be going up to Luther Glen July 7th through the 12th. They have another week that has a little broader age range at the end of the month of July. And our camp, too, has received some really generous donations that make it very affordable for people. They have kind of a choose-your-own rate that you can pay to participate in camp. And so it's a wonderful summer to take advantage of that gift and go be a part of camp. And then for those who don't want to go up the hill, camp will also be brought to us here August 5th, the week of August 5th, for our Vacation Bible School. So that's going to be coming up. There's going to be ways to volunteer for that. But most importantly, we want to help spread the word to get to our kids in our community to come be a part of that great week with us, VBS August 5th. Any other announcements from you, Pastor Manuel? Okay.
Excuse me. I don't think LWR is meeting again until next month.
Oh, good to know. All right. Thank you for that, Mimi. And then as you were coming in, some of you might have come in when we were playing a video. Global Refuge, which was formerly Lutheran Immigration and Refugee Services, was here earlier this spring trying to capture a little bit of Wah and Trinh Nguyen's story of having to flee Vietnam and then coming to the U.S. and then finding community here at St. Andrew's. And they put this beautiful documentary, it's about 9 minutes of story, of their story, that was released this week. And so hopefully you've had a chance to watch that. If you haven't, we're going to watch it again after service in here on the screens. We had it on just as you were walking in because we found out Juan and Trin, who are at our 8:30 service, hadn't seen it yet. So we got to actually have that experience of being with them when they watched it the first time. And it spurred all sorts of memories for Juan Trin as well. So a really special thing to be able to share in that. So if you want to stick around, we'll have, I guess, our second premiere after the service today. So you can watch that video. It'll be about 9 minutes. All right. And then one final announcement. We have a flower arrangement here. This was given in celebration of Sue Teague's retirement. After 35 years teaching elementary school, Sue has retired. And so these flowers are given in celebration. So if you see Sue, you can tell her congratulations on your retirement. I think those are all of our announcements. We'll continue now with our call to worship. Thank you.
speaks and the sun of his
love is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me be falling, or winds be blowing through the forest of gloom, his voice to me is calling. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own.
We continue now with our confession. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, abounding in steadfast love toward us, healing the sick and raising the dead, showering us with every good gift. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Just and gracious God, we come to you for healing and life. Our sins hurt others and diminish us. We confess them to you. Our lives bear the scars of sin. We bring these also to you. Show us your mercy, O God. Bind our wounds, forgive us our sins, and free us to love for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The Apostle Paul assures us, when we are dead in our trespasses, God made us alive together with Christ, nailing the record of our sins to the cross. Jesus says to you, your sins are forgiven. Be at peace and tell everyone how much God has done for you. Amen. We'll sing our opening hymn, When Peace Like a River.
Oh,
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of creation, eternal majesty, you preside over land and sea, sunshine and storm. By your strength, pilot us. By your power, preserve us. By your wisdom, instruct us. And by your hand, protect us through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We'll continue with our reading. It says Lamentations there, but we're actually reading from Job 38, so I would follow along in your bulletins for this one. Yeah.
First reading is from Job 38, 1 through 11. The Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind. Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up your loins like a man. I will question you, and you shall declare to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me, if you have understanding, who determined its measurements? Surely you know, or who stretched the line upon it? On what were its bases sunk, or who laid its cornerstone when the morning stars sang together and all the heavenly beings shouted for joy? Or who shut in the sea with doors when it burst out from the womb, when I made the clouds its garment and thick darkness its swaddling band and prescribed bounds for it and set bars and doors and said, thus far shall you come and no farther, and here shall your proud waves be stopped. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the fourth chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When evening had come, Jesus said to the disciples, let us go across to the other side. And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat so that the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him and said to him, teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace, be still. Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. And he said to them, why are you afraid? Have you still no faith? And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? The gospel of the Lord. So this week I was at Holden Village, which is on the eastern slope of the Cascades in Washington. As the description reads from Holden Village website, Holden Village welcomes all people to form and renew their relationships with God, the earth, and each other. This was my third year as teaching faculty at Holden. Teaching every day our Indian 101, Truth and Healing, and our border and immigration material with my brother Vance Black Fox. Holden Village is one of the most remote, continuously inhabited communities in the lower 48. The remoteness is largely why guests love to retreat there. Many would say it's a little slice of heaven. So to help you understand how remote Holden Village is, I will share what my journey was like as I made my way back to civilization and cell service on Friday. So we loaded on the bus from the village at 9:45 a.m. and arrived at the boat dock at 11. So it is just over an hour's drive down a gravel road and switchbacks to get down to Lake Chelan. We got on the ferry at 11:20. We didn't arrive at the dock on the other side of the lake until 6:30. My brother Vance and I then drove to the other side of the Cascades, journeying the 4 hours to the hotel near SeaTac Airport. Now I'm still trying to wrap my head around how my journey started 9:45 in the morning and ended 13 hours later at 11 p.m. It did help to be on a literal lake, though, to create this sermon and this message from our gospel text this morning. This famous story of Jesus calming the storms over the water. Jesus invites the disciples into the boat to travel across to the other side, the Sea of Galilee, headed for the shore there. And according to Mark, this is actually the first of several journeys they will take together to the other side in our gospel. And as they travel back and forth from one side of the Sea of Galilee to the other, there is more than just geography at work. For the writer of Mark, one side of the Sea of Galilee symbolizes the home territory of the people, of the Jewish people. It is familiar and relatively safe for the disciples and for Jesus, and is filled with people, language, and a culture they knew and understood. But the other side of the Sea of Galilee, is everything east of the Jordan River, which flows in and out of that sea, and is the land of the Gentiles. On the other side, everything is very different and uncomfortable to them. It was so different that it likely made them fearful and anxious. The River Jordan and the Sea of Galilee serve as a natural and cultural border that keeps these two groups of people separate from one another. And I cannot help but think of Holden Village in the same way. In some ways, it is a foreign place to me. It's so Lutheran, Norwegian, and Swedish. And it has been for 62 years. For so many, it represents a place of escape and spiritual new over those six decades. There's no television, no radio, and no cell service. And so whatever craziness in the news or in our society is happening outside of Holden, you wouldn't know, and you wouldn't have any way of knowing. It is like closing your eyes and truly retreating from all the troubles and all that divides our society and our world. However long you might retreat to a place, all the troubles and divides and all the things that divide us are still there for us when we leave and journey to the other side of the lake. Now think of the many things that divide us in our world. Israel and Palestine and the whole Middle East, really. Russia and Ukraine. North and South Korea. Racial and socioeconomic division in our cities and in our communities, and the division between each other through our political parties. The divides are so many, and the wounds are so deep, and those walls we put up are so high. And though we spend an inordinate amount of time and money protecting and defending our boundary lines, does anyone really feel safe, secure, or at peace on either side? The disease of fear, anxiety, and hatred infects our world. And Jesus was born into a world much like ours. Religious and political taxation widened economic chasms already present. Samaritans and Jews had nothing to do with each other. The clean did not touch the unclean, the circumcised would not eat with the uncircumcised, and the righteous did not associate with sinners and tax collectors. They all knew what was on the other side, and it was to be feared. No one dared to make the journey to the other side. No one except this fellow, this rabbi, Jesus. He not only didn't seem afraid of those on the other side, but he chose to cross those divisions and boundaries and to call them out. He made his way many times across the Sea of Galilee and the Jordan. He taught and preached truth and brought healing to a people so ill and infected by division created by those in political and religious power. Jesus and the disciples will travel by boat four times across the Sea of Galilee and back. On one side, he'll feed 5,000 hungry Jews, and then on the other, he will feed a crowd of Gentiles. Jesus heals both the daughter of Jairus, a leader of the synagogue, and another daughter of Israel, a woman who suffered for 12 years with hemorrhages, leaving her isolated from her family and her community. But then he crosses the sea again and goes to the region of Tyre, where he heals a little girl, a Syrophoenician woman, who was considered to be no better than a dog by those who lived on the Jewish side. From there, he travels towards the sea in the region of Decapolis, where people bring to him a man, a Gentile, who cannot hear and who suffers from some sort of speech impediment. And Jesus gently pulls him aside. With a touch and a word, opens his ears and loosens his tongue. He journeys across these boundaries to feed the hungry, heal the sick, and bring God's hope to those on both sides of every divide. Even and especially today, Jesus arrives from the other side to bring hope and healing to people divided in our world. And he wanted his disciples to be part of this ministry. He came to create a reconciled community, one new humanity, where many factions had been. But he also came to call a reconciling community a people whose lives were spent mending divides, tearing down the walls, bridging the chasms, and taking risk of loving the stranger, the other, even the so-called enemy. And so Jesus called his disciples to get into the boat and travel with him across the sea, to become part of the hymn that could piece together again what fear, hatred, arrogance, ignorance had shredded. But the disciples did not want to go. They resisted the call in many different ways. They didn't want to go with Jesus to the other side. And a windstorm came when Jesus and his disciples were crossing to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. And the boat was taking on water, and those fishermen who knew about boats and knew about the Sea of Galilee recognized the danger they were in. And the disciples woke up their sleeping rabbi in fear asked, "Don't you care if we'll drown?" And Jesus woke up, stilled the wind, calmed the sea with one word of peace. And then after the sea was calm and the disciples seemed to feel safe, the disciples were actually still truly terrified. And Jesus asked them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" The disciples seemed more frightened by the prospect of having to complete the journey to the other side. Now that the storm had been stilled, they were still kind of drowning in their fear. They were afraid of what awaited them now on the other side. And the writer of the Gospel of Luke also knew, understood the crowd to whom he was writing this gospel to. He knew that they were struggling in their ministry of hospitality and reconciliation. It wasn't easy for those first Christians to mend the torn seams between Jews and Gentiles, male and female, rich and poor, slave and free, in equity and love. All kinds of storms came when they chose the way and followed the Messiah, Jesus. Parents disown their children for eating with the wrong people. Those in power spread rumors about these first Christians, calling them traitors and even cannibals. Those early Christians were persecuted by those in authority and power, both political and religious. The writer of Mark writes to give them encouragement and hope in their journey and in their struggle, reminding them that Jesus is in the boat with them, telling them again and again that God's love is more powerful than economic systems, governmental powers, and even religious laws. Soon they will see that it is even more powerful than death itself. It is in the cross that we see Jesus cross the eternal divide for us, the divide caused by sin and death, only to rise again to overcome death with forgiveness and life, not just for him, but for the entire creation. The call to ministry of hospitality, reconciliation, and healing isn't any easier now than it was 2,000 years ago. Even so, this is the ministry to which we have been called to in our baptisms. Every storm and division that arises and brings chaos to this long journey of those who call themselves Jesus' disciples, to journey outside the comfort and safety, to mend the divides of this world, to be disciples and to make disciples. Sometimes being disciples of Jesus and followers of this rabbi will mean we may be up against some giants in this world. We will speak against customs and attitudes that fuel fear and anger. We will work to change customs that put people outside of our own world. We will find ourselves struggling against that current and buffeted by winds and waves, even sometimes within a church, within our own church, and the larger church. When religion becomes part of that storm that impedes Christ's ministry of healing and reconciliation, God sends some anxious disciples to journey to the other side and to speak the word of love and hope again to a frightened and reluctant people. We do not make these journeys alone. We travel with one another, for we have been sown together into community. Although we are afraid to travel outside our familiar territory, we travel together like siblings, giving each other enough strength to hold on through the winds and the waves to make that crossing to the other side. And in fact, we travel with all those who have made this journey before us. Those saints, the prophets, and the disciples of Jesus. We are part of a long line of people who have been called to journey to the other side, to live without walls. And to those we once called a stranger or enemy, now a friend. And we're given food for this journey. Not a lot, but enough to nourish and sustain our souls. As each week we gather around this altar or table and are fed to be sent outside of our little village of St. Andrews, sent by Jesus into unknown territory for the sake of the stranger. And it's here that we are gathered to hear God's word, the gospel, remembering our baptisms where we journeyed from death to new life. and we do this daily, and we're given the bread of grace to eat and the wine of peace to drink, sent on our way, empowered by the Holy Spirit. And we travel with Jesus himself, the one who can still the storm of chaos, subdue the power of sin, goes with us back and forth from one side to the other as we remember that God's healing love is with us wherever we go. Thanks be to God.
Actually, we're going to go straight into our time of prayer, Wilson, so if you could go to that slide. As we continue with our prayers, we're praying for prayers of safe travels for Jen and friends. This is Mary Thomas's daughter, as well as for Frank and Lori Herman. And then prayers of peace and comfort for the family and friends of Adam Neely, Diana Osborne's friend. Also, we're praying prayers of healing for Lois Yar. Lois had a fall this last week and had to have stitches on her elbow. So she's just a little bit sore, but doing okay. So prayers of healing for her and rest. At the end of each petition, we'll say, Lord, in your mercy, and you're welcome to respond by saying, hear our prayer. We come before the triune God to pray for our communities, ourselves, and our world.
Equip your faithful people to approach this world with a sense of wonder. Make your church a safe place to explore big questions, troubling doubts, and honest laments. Humble our hearts to repent of the ways that communities of faith have inflicted pain or trauma. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You spoke creation into order from the chaos of the swirling deep. May your name be praised by rivers and seas, wetlands and waterfalls. Secure clean water for all people and protect water sources from contamination or exploitation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Amid whirlwinds of division, violence, and conflict, remind us again that you are as steadfast as the foundations of the earth. rejuvenate peacemakers, advocates, and community organizers when they feel weary in their work. We pray especially for the work of Global Refuge around the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Enfold all travelers with your protection. Bless the comings and goings of this assembly as we travel for leisure or for work. Let all journeys be met with hospitality on the way, and let community members return to us rested and renewed. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Deliver your people from their distress, O God. We lift before you all who are sick or struggling. Grant consolation and peace to all who live with chronic, terminal, or persistent illness. In times of affliction or hardship, sustain us in faith. We offer now the silent prayers of our hearts.
Lord, in your mercy, receive our prayers, O God, and come quickly to our aid through the power of the Spirit and the love of Jesus Christ. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share a sign of God's peace with all those around you. God's peace be with you. If you're online with us, God's peace be with you wherever you are. Peace be with you, Rob. And at this time, we'll continue with the receiving of the offering. So the offering plates are going to come around. We also have information about online giving posted in the chat, as well as in our announcements and in the bulletins. And we're so grateful for all the ways that we get to give to God together as a part of St. Andrew's. And we're especially grateful for the gift of our musicians. They're going to lead us in our offering song.
So glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound. Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound. Jesus lifted me, Satan had me bound. Jesus lifted me, singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me, when I was in trouble. Jesus lifted me, when I was in trouble. Jesus lifted me, when I was in trouble. Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me.
Lost my mic.
Let us pray. Risen One,
fruit, may the gifts that we offer here be signs of your abiding love. Form us to be your witnesses in the world through Jesus Christ, our true vine. Amen. All right, I want to invite the kids up for children's time. We're going to do an activity up here. Today we are talking in the story about how Jesus goes back and forth to help people come together, all in God's love. And we're going to do a fun activity today. Have any of you ever made a human knot before? Have you ever made a human knot? Okay, we're going to try this. So everyone has to stand up. What we're going to do is we're going to make a knot, and then we're going to have to untangle ourselves. But the only way that we can do this is if you all come down here with me, And then you have to take the hands of somebody else, but you can't take both their hands, okay? So everybody find two hands to grab, but they have to be from two different people. There we go. Okay, this is not going to be that hard. Okay, well, that's okay. It's our first time. So we're going to untangle our human knot. So what do you think we have to do first? I think I have to go like this, right? And then maybe like this. Okay, how are we doing? We can switch our hands. We don't have to hurt ourselves. There we go. How's our knot looking? Are we untangled yet?
Yes, we're untangled.
Oh, look at that. We did that. So should we make it a little harder this time?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Here we go. Oh, you need who? I was like, there has to be a hand for every hand. There we go. Okay. But you two have the same hand.
Frank, I need to hold your hand.
So we got to switch because you can't have the same hands. Two different hands. There we go. Okay, what are we going to do first? Unknot ourselves.
I don't know.
I think you're over your head there would be a good place to start. There we go. Okay. I'm going to go like this. You can switch your hand. Here we go. You're stuck? What's going to happen?
Oh,
wait. Oh, there's something happened just now. No, we're not quite done. Here we go. If we go over here. Is this too hard?
Yes.
We have to work together to figure this out. Somehow I got to get next to. We're in two different circles. How did we do that? Oh my gosh. We're so good at that game. We beat the game. I was thinking, how was I going to end up next to Kyrie? I couldn't figure out how I was going to get over there to you. Actually, that kind of works out nicely, right? Yeah, another one. Yeah, so what happened the second time?
We split up into two groups.
We were all tangled up together. We didn't even realize we were two different. And we made a hectagon? Are you learning shapes right now? Because that's a pretty cool. Yeah, so when you're all confused by something, what helps you when you're kind of all jumbled up and confused by something? What can help you when you're in a time like that? Yeah. Reading? Oh, that's so good. How does reading help you, Kyrie? It calms you down and lets you see other things. Sometimes when something is confusing or hard for you, do you feel like you need to take a break and get a different perspective? Isn't that great advice for all of us? Kyrie, that's wonderful. What else can help you when you're feeling confused? Yes. Oh, glasses? Something about glasses and hats. But you know what? If you are someone who needs glasses and you don't have them on, boy, does it make a difference when you put your glasses on. I can speak from that. That can also clear up some confusion really quick. And in fact, when my mom... You don't know if you're going to bump into something. My mom, when she was a little kid, her family didn't know she needed glasses. And then she talks about how the first time she finally got glasses put on, she didn't know that there were leaves on trees. She thought it was just a big old blob of green. And then when they figured out she needed glasses, all of a sudden she could see the leaves. And she still remembers that. And she was probably a little kid, you know, maybe in elementary school. Yeah, what else can help you? Taking a nap can help you, right? Yeah, a little nap. Well, one thing I was thinking when we were doing our human knots, right? We were all jumbled and confused all together, but it made a difference when we worked together to figure out what was going on, right? Even in that second time when it was confusing and we had two different circles and we didn't even realize it, right? Working together, paying attention to each other so you can figure out the problem together can be a really cool thing. And that's kind of what Jesus was talking about when he was with his disciples. They were in the boat. This big confusing storm came, and he was like, don't worry, I'm with you. We're going to work this out together, right? And he was taking them on a journey to go help people. Like a knot, yeah. Sometimes we do. Things in life can kind of make us all feel tangled up. And so it can be helpful to have other people to work things through with, huh?
It was still fun.
It was still fun, yeah. Thankfully. Thankfully, nobody fell over, right? That would have been hard. Or what would you do if you were all stuck in that knot and you couldn't get untangled and you had to just go the rest of your day like that? That would have been hard, right? Yeah, it's a good thing we worked together to figure it out.
Okay, we're going to turn around for communion. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so we remember in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you." And then what does he say? "Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin." And then he says, "Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your love and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All right, you all can return to your seats. I do want to welcome you all to communion this morning. You do not need to be a member of this church or Lutheran. All are welcome to come forward, eat, drink, and receive. We're going to make a circle here around the altar. You just stay on the lowest level. We'll come around and serve you a piece of bread, an individual cup of wine or grape juice. We also have gluten-free crackers, so if you need that, let us know. And then the wine is the lighter color liquid. The grape juice is the darker color one. We'll come and collect your empty cups, and then after that, you'll be invited to take hands with your neighbors. We'll offer you a blessing, then following that blessing, you can return to your seats down the side aisles. If you're not communing at this time, you're still welcome to come forward. We just ask you fold your hands, and we'll offer you a blessing instead. And if you're not wearing a name tag, it is our practice to serve communion by first name, so we may be asking you for your name. That's everything you need to know. The table's been prepared, and all are welcome.
Standing on the ground.
his toes and snares. His grace has brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. I've got a peaceful, easy feeling. I know you won't let me
I just told the musicians we were making a human knot over there. It all worked out.
Let us pray. Shepherding God, you have prepared a table before us and nourished us with your love. Send us forth from this banquet to proclaim your goodness and share the abundant mercy of Jesus, our Redeemer and friend.
Amen. So now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Our closing hymn is Shall We Gather at the... Wait, is that right? I'm looking at the wrong bulletin. Okay, good. Verse 1 and 4 of Shall We Gather at the River.
Yeah. And you're going to want to stick around after the service for the video.
Yeah. So we'll show the video after the service. Check out, there's brownie bites and coffee and then the craft and bake sale here. And then for those staying for new members class, we'll get that set up in just a few moments.
I'd like to invite all the kids up forward or anyone that's a kid at heart to join us for Jesus Loves Me. Come on up. Yay! We got some members of the band coming up. Yay, yay, yay.
Well, some of it I know,
Yeah,
or it just is intuitive.
Right. to immigrants. We're only about 25 miles from the border with Mexico.
I think the